Okay, we got some people trickling in, but I'm going to get started. This is the voting and simulcast for repeaters topic. I am Matthew Kaufman.
I have no idea.
I will tell you more about myself in just a minute. We really will cover voting and simulcast and some other repeater topics. If you're in the wrong room, you should stick around anyway. So, I am Matthew. I got my license as KA6SQG, super complicated to get right in logbook or send with CW, so I've never changed it. In 1981, I was 11 years old, and I'm going to announce today, this is my oldest kid here, he's 10, stand up, Adrian, and he just passed his technician test of about 2 hours by a year and a license class. So now we got to get the 8-year-old studying, see if he can't get it done by 9. And
but no pressure.
The 2-year-old, you know, she can't read yet, so she's really slow on the 1984, put together my first repeater in Los Altos Hills, built a controller out of a 6800 and a bunch of randomly acquired parts. This was back in the era of the ACC repeater controllers, first talking repeaters. I basically built a clone of that out of spare parts. And I give this talk a lot to, our version of this talk, to a lot of people who do public safety stuff. If you're interested in public safety, in particular fire communications, and you live anywhere from the south end of Monterey County to the middle of San Mateo County, my website, www.firescan.net, records all of that, does a bunch of DSP on it, indexes it in a database. You can see how that works. So, we'll get started. Why do we have repeaters? We have repeaters because reliable VHF and UHF propagation in line of sight. There's lots of other ways to talk on VHF and UHF that go farther. But they're not what you would use for the kinds of things we build repeaters for. So let's say there's a big bike race coming up, you don't say, well, you know, hopefully we'll get some good tropospheric ducting today, and it'll work out. And if we don't get ducting, well, net control won't be able to talk to anybody, but that's okay. No, we build repeaters because instead of just talking to what you can see, now you can talk to the repeaters that you can see and to everything they can see. And that's a much wider communications area. The other thing, and this is why a lot of public safety entities use repeaters, is they create a shared communication environment. So you have a conversation where every single person who is participating in the conversation has an opportunity to speak, and they have an opportunity to be heard by everyone in the conversation. You have a simplex communication going on a long bike race or something, you're trying to talk to the far end of the race, it doesn't happen, you gotta relay messages. Can it be done? Yes. Do we have to do that sometimes? Absolutely. But it's more efficient for everyone to be able to hear what's going on. And as I say, police and fire, they use this because they want to be able to hop out of a car, start talking, start describing the scene, start asking for backup. And people are coming in, they're hearing the whole picture as they're coming in. So, how do we make this conversation area bigger? Right? Goal is to make this cover more area. Well, the first thing is you pick a good repeater site. So if you're out in the Midwest, you find the tallest TV tower, which is typically already located for you in a really great place to cover the majority of the population, and you put your repeater and the antenna on the top of that tower. Super easy. Except for some politics. Or money, or both. But around here, where we have mountains, that doesn't work. You can't just go up, you can't say, well, I'm going to put a repeater on the tallest mountain, that's just going to cover everything. Right? Mount Diablo, great place to put a repeater. Does not cover the Santa Cruz coastline. Does not cover Big Sur. Can't. It's not in range, right?
Doesn't cover the East Bay.
Doesn't hardly cover the East Bay. There you go. and so you got to put it there, and as you said, the best place is often not the closest peak. If you're sitting down in San Jose, you want something, or on the peninsula especially, you want to talk to somebody on the peninsula, on the bay side of the peninsula, you want a repeater in the East Bay. You want to talk to the East Bay? Put your repeater over on Skyline, up above Woodside, say, and you'll get a great shot of the entire other side. And that's because you've got all these valleys coming up. And if you try to put the repeater right there, it's going to talk into one or two and just be shadowed for the rest. The other thing you can do is you can drop the frequency, right? So you can go down to 2 meters. If you're at 440, you go down to 6 meters. 6 meters gets better penetration, goes through foliage better. But there's a bunch of trade-offs. Some of my repeaters are at places where if I went back to the site owner and said, hey, you know, I've changed my mind. I don't want to be on 440 anymore. I've got these new cavities that are this big, and I have 6 of them. Where would you like me to put that? The answer would be, you can't have a repeater here. The next thing you can do is you can go beyond a single site. That's what you do if you can't find one site that works for everybody. And we'll talk about each one of these things, starting with very simple and getting to be a little overly complicated. So, multiple repeaters. You put in multiple repeaters on different frequencies, or maybe you have other people put in multiple repeaters on different frequencies, and then you just choose the right repeater for the conversation you want to have. Now, some advantages. Often these repeaters are built by different people. In the ham radio space especially, you can just choose any of the open repeaters that work for you and the people you want to talk to. Drawbacks are that you have to know which repeater to use. I know what repeaters to use around here. I certainly know what repeaters to use down in Santa Cruz when I'm down there. Yeah, I have no idea what I'd use if I went down to Los Angeles. I'm sure there's some open repeaters there. I can look in the repeater directory. But I don't just know, you know, oh, hey, when I drive past this exit on the freeway, I'm going to drop out of this repeater. I can pick up that one. The other thing is that these conversations, where they are shared on a single repeater, are not shared between the repeaters. So if you're trying to have a coordinated event, you're trying to disseminate information to people, and they're on different repeaters, you're going to have to come out on different repeaters and transmit that same message in multiple places. But by default, ham radio gives you this already. Synthesized radio, bunch of repeaters, you're done. The next thing you can do is you can take a bunch of repeaters and put them all on the same frequency. Now, not too common in ham radio. It's done occasionally. We certainly see that there's some groups, I don't know of any right in the Bay Area, but there's certainly out in Hollister, for instance, they've got sort of a primary repeater, and if that's offline, they have a secondary repeater. It's just a different PL tone, same frequency. But we do see this a lot by entities like Cal Fire and state parks. They put up a bunch of repeaters, and you dial up on your radio which tone you want to use, and that puts you through the correct repeater. Now, the advantage here is you've got the same conversation with some overlap. So if you're responding to an incident, you're driving into an area, as you get closer, you're getting closer and closer to the repeater they're using for that area, and so you're going to get more and more of the context, and by the time you're on scene, you know exactly what's going on. Downside, of course, is to the extent you wanted to have multiple conversations, it doesn't help you, right? So that's again, the trade-off here. One conversation, lots of conversations. And you'll see this trade-off come up multiple times. Now, yet an even wider coverage area, you can have multiple linked repeaters. You link those together a bunch of ways. You can have an in-band linking. You just have a repeater that's got a remote base, say a 440 that's got a 2-meter remote. Dial that up on somebody else's 2-meter repeater. Now you've got a wider communication area, same shared conversation. You can build these with simplex or duplex RF linking. There's several linked repeater systems around the state that work this way. You can all link to a central hub repeater, maybe link in on 420 or 440. You got a bunch of 2-meter repeaters, or you got a bunch of UHF repeaters linked in to a central 440 or 900 hub. And you can use voice over IP, IRLP, Echo Link, things like that. Now, this is great because now we've finally gotten to this one shared conversation over a very wide area. But we still have the requirement that the user know what to do. So if it's IRLP or Echo Link, the user might have to dial up the correct reflector if a repeater's not connected in. Even in the case where you've got these dedicated links where they're tied together all the time, you still need to know which repeater. Which repeater works when I'm in Gilroy? Which repeater should I be on when I'm in downtown San Francisco? You have to have that knowledge, and you have to use that knowledge as you're moving through the area. It's not impossible, not even necessarily a bad thing, but that's sort of, you know, now we've got this, we're kind of coming over this hump here to where now we've got really good wide area coverage, and it works pretty well, and the drawbacks are seeming less like drawbacks. Now, we're going to take a little side trip here. We're going to talk about remote receivers. Often, when you build a repeater, you put the repeater up on a nice high place, nice antenna, lots of power. Your users are on handhelds. Not a lot of power, really bad antennas. Tend to hold them funny. Put them in their pocket, use a speaker mic, things like that. So, one of the ways to balance this out, to improve the repeater coverage area, to balance that coverage area, is you put remote receivers in. So you can put a receiver that receives maybe in one of the edge cities that you cover, but that you don't cover with handheld coverage. Maybe you even put one that looks, you know, right into a parking garage that's really popular with your users, but it has no handheld coverage at all. And then these remote receivers are linked back to the repeater, and they can come back on RF or wireline, obviously not on the repeater input frequency, because that's where they're listening, but they can come back on some sort of link. And then the users can select which remote receiver using something like selecting a subaudible tone for which receiver they want, or use some sort of default behavior. There was a system in Mountain View, Silicon Valley area for a while, but may still work this way. I've certainly worked this way when I was a kid. Had a primary receiver and a repeater, and it had a remote receiver. The deal was, the remote receiver had its squelch cranked up pretty high, but if the remote receiver heard you, you got the remote receiver. If the remote receiver didn't hear you, you'd use a primary receiver. It's a heuristic, it works, it expands the receiver area. We want to get a little fancier than that, we go to receiver voting. So now, instead of having to pick which receiver you want, the system picks the receiver for you. And it uses signal-to-noise ratio or some other thing like signal strength telemetry coming back. And then, as you move around, maybe it even can switch which receiver is receiving you, and then retransmit sort of the best sounding signal or the strongest signal. Now, this gets a little more complicated because all of these receivers need to be linked back to where that voting decision happens simultaneously. Unlike a simple remote receiver setup where you maybe have two or three remotes, tone selected, these all have to come in on different links so that they can all be received simultaneously and the choice made. Now that we've talked a little about voting, the other way to do this to expand the transmit coverage area is to put voting decisions at the user side. You get a receiver that listens and says, hey, I know there's 7 different channels involved in this conversation, and it picks whichever one sounds best. This is used in some public safety and commercial trunking radio systems. They'll listen for a control channel. When the control channel gets weak, they'll scan, they'll pick up the next best control channel. They'll lock onto that, and they'll get the conversations there. In the case where they have to register, they'll even register the unit to say, hey, I've moved to this new zone. Works pretty well. Combine this with receiver voting, and you got a pretty good system. Problem with this for typical today ham radio use is you can't go out and buy a $35 handheld that does this. Even if you could buy a $35 handheld that does this, you can't program it from the front panel to work with one of these. Because you got to have system ID codes, you got to have talk groups, and all this stuff set up. But this does exist. Technically, this is one of the solutions. And now we've finally gotten to the point where we have wider than a single repeater's coverage area. We have no requirement on the user that they know how to switch channels or PL tones, and it just works. But unfortunately, we can't deploy this for traditional analog FM radios that you can buy off the shelf for cheap. That's where Simulcast comes in. So what if you didn't need to pick which repeater site you were on at all? That's easy. You do a bunch of linked repeaters, all on exactly the same frequency, that are transmitting in overlapping coverage areas at exactly the same time. And you combine that with receiver vote. Right? Who here knows about simulcast and has actually used some? Okay, a few. Now you guys know what's coming next. So the big advantage is here, everybody's participating, one conversation, one frequency, nothing to adjust. We have spectrum conservation, big deal for public safety, not as much for him. We have a virtual repeater coverage area that's way bigger than you can get from any one site, and you can build what are essentially impossible repeater coverage areas. So for instance, I have a repeater system that works this way. You can drive over Highway 17 and there's no holes anywhere. You can't do that from any one site. It's physically impossible to do because any site that covers most of 17 drops out in Los Gatos, unless you cover Los Gatos, in which case it drops off on the Santa Cruz side. So it's great. It's only one problem. There's a catch. Like all great things, there's a catch. So, the catch is that you need incredibly precise frequency control and audio phase control. More than you're used to. So 1 hertz of error at 400 megahertz is 0.0025 parts per million. Who here is carrying a handheld that is that stable? Okay, how about 0.25 parts per million?
0.25?
Sure.
Probably.
One part per million. Five parts per million. Unless it's a really cheap one, so most people can raise their hand. Seven parts per million, maybe. Okay. Typical amateur stability that we're looking for is around 5 parts per million. Commercial base stations are typically 1 to 2.5 parts per million. This is orders of magnitude worse than we need. Okay? So we need something much better than this. We need something so precise that we start to see Doppler effects. So if you are moving at 60 miles an hour, and you've got a repeater in front of you and a repeater behind you, and they're on exactly the same frequency, they're not on the same frequency anymore. They're in fact 72 hertz apart, because the one in front of you is 36 hertz higher, and the one behind you is 36 hertz lower. The good news is 72 hertz is still subaudible, and so this works. If we move the transmit frequency up, then we find that the speed at which you can go and make this work goes down. So it's kind of tricky. But at UHF, we can pretty much make this go. Now, phase error. We want about 10% phase error in the overlapped areas. No worse than that. Or it starts to sound bad. So at 3,000 hertz, which is the worst end of that, that's 10 microseconds of error. So that means we've got to have matching modulator phase response, matching frequency and phase response on those links to the modulators. We got to make sure that the error in the overlapped area is 50 to 60 microseconds, which means about 10 microseconds at the transmitters because of the varying distance. And now we have this other problem. Not only do we have these Doppler effects, but we have this huge problem with the speed of light. It doesn't go fast enough. So in order to have all your links stay within 10 microseconds, they'd all have to be less than 18 miles. And obviously building a linked repeater system that's only 18 miles radius isn't super exciting. The whole point here was to make a larger coverage area. So now we're going to have to do something to that audio. We're going to have to delay that audio.
Matthew?
Yes?
So doesn't the capture effect help you here with FM?
The capture effect helps you at when you're close to one repeater and far from another. Where the capture effect doesn't help you is where the signal sinks are approximately equal, and that is exactly where these kinds of phase errors and things matter. So, here's how you build one in real life. You get a bunch of matched repeaters that have external frequency reference inputs. You can buy them. They're expensive, but you can buy them. You get some high stability reference oscillators. You link them all over high quality audio paths. You get a signal to noise voter, and you send it back out to the repeater sites. Send the signal that comes in back out to all of those. You get precision audio delays in the path, typically digital audio delays, though there are some analog approaches to this. And then you tune and maintain this whole system. And they're super expensive. Okay? If you have a three-site repeater system, it already exists, has already got microwave and T1 between all the sites, it's all ready to go, it's already got external frequency reference inputs, all you need to do is upgrade it to work like this, you're talking about $250,000, $300,000.
Wow.
That's what they charge public safety entities to do that kind of upgrade. You want to build a new one, say four or five sites, and you don't already own this gear, millions of dollars. Now, I spend a lot of money on my repeater system. More than I should. Way more than I should. But I don't have millions of dollars to spend on the repeater system. So this is not going to happen. So now we're going to talk about, if you have any questions about the theory of voting, simulcast, linking, any of those things before I get into the specifics of how you build one of these. Okay. So I have built, along with a bunch of help, a seven-site repeater system. Five of those sites are on the simulcast system. We have GPS locked frequency and audio. We phase match all the receive audio, which is not typically done. That means that instead of having a lot of voter hysteresis where we choose one site and then wait until it gets really noisy to switch, we actually switch if necessary every 20 milliseconds. All of this linking is done with voice over IP and generally amateur microwave links between the sites. Some obligatory pictures, some of them old. There's my dad at the Amunam site. That's me on the tower a long time ago, installing an antenna, which still works. Yes?
What's the precise frequency that you put the repeaters on? Zero? You put them all on exactly the same from one.
I put them all on exactly the same frequency.
Okay. Yeah, but because the paging systems were up to 5 hertz off.
Yeah, so UHF, public safety, and paging tends to be right on frequency. As you go down in frequency, you do create nulls as a result of transmitting on exactly the same frequency from multiple sites. And as the frequency goes down, multipath effects are less, and so the primary paths are greater. And that combined with the width of those nulls physically, because of the longer wavelength, means that there is some advantage to doing offsets, so that stationary stations have the nulls move over them. When you get down to VHF low band, for sure you do that. VHF high band, they think it's a good idea. I don't really think it's a good idea. It certainly doesn't matter if you're mobile. Because if you're mobile, there's two things happening. One is you're moving through those nulls, and two is, because of Doppler, nothing's on the same frequency anyway.
Right.
Here's up on Mount Allison. Bunch of commercial grade outdoor gear because we don't like to fix it. There's a repeater rack there. And here's my wife helping out on Toro. This is a nice antenna, but about 110 feet there on Mount Toro. So, talk a little about the evolution of the system. Start out, as I said, with some old tube type gear, Micor, GE, mobile gear converted. And we start putting stuff on mountaintops. We happened to choose the Yaesu Vertex VXR 5000. It was a low-end, commercial, high-end, amateur, standalone repeater package. It's nice because you can just buy it off the shelf, you didn't have to screw with it, and it's turned out to be really advantageous for us because it's right at that sort of scale where you can still get in and modify the modules and do what you have to do to make this work, and still new enough that we're not dealing with leaky old capacitors and things like that. So we built this up, multiple sites, standalone repeaters, tone selected, all on the same frequency. And then we figured out we could build simulcast. So for frequency stability, the first thing that really happened here is a device called the Z3801A from HP came out. It was surplused out of a large number of cell sites, partially because when it gets hot, it dies. And so they upgraded to newer gear that doesn't die when it gets hot. And I've had a couple of them die, but if you take care of them, they don't all die right away. It's a double oven, ovenized crystal oscillator. It gives you one part in 10 to the 11th short-term frequency stability, all on its own. So over 1 to 2 seconds, that's its stability. And then that's disciplined to GPS. GPS, of course, has atomic clocks on board the GPS satellites. If you know where you are, which you do for fixed stations, and if you don't, you can just wait a while and monitor the GPS signal, and now you do know where you are. Once you know where you are, you can find out what time it actually is at your location by looking at the time of the GPS satellite, the time of flight to you. That, now that selective availability is turned off, gives you 1 part in 10 to the 12th, long-term stability, with no visits out to the site.
What did you need? You thought you needed 1 part in 10 to the 2.5 and 10 to the 9?
Is about, yeah.
Okay.
Couple in 10 to the 9th.
Right.
So this is significantly better than we need. Here's how good it is. You go to the site to maintain the site, you take your service monitor to the site, you key up the repeater transmitter, you adjust the service monitor until the service monitor says there's no frequency error, because the repeater is a traceable frequency standard, and they proceed, kind of backwards from the ordinary one. So now you just need to get the repeater transmitter locked to this reference. You got this box, it's receiving GPS, it's taking in 48 volts, inconveniently, and outputting some 10 megahertz. So, frequency synthesizers. Everybody knows how frequency synthesizers work by now. You take a reference oscillator, potentially prescale that. You got a phase detector and a loop filter. That output of that runs a VCO. The VCO becomes your transmit oscillator. You divide and you run that into a phase detector to see how far off you are. Now you can do even more fancy, you can do a two-loop thing, and you can do fractional end synthesis, but basic frequency synthesis works like this. And what that means is that people tend to choose reference oscillator frequencies that, when divided by integers, give you the kinds of steps you would like to see on the front panel of the radio. So you see things like 10.24 megahertz, 16.8 is really popular, that'll get you 2.5, 5, 6.25, 7.5, 12.5, all those steps are available as integer divides for 16.8. We do see a lot of 12.8 and 19.2 as well. 12.8 happens to be what the ASU vertex repeater uses. Now, none of those are 10 megahertz, unfortunately, but it's easy to synthesize those from 10 megahertz. But why do something like that when you can avoid that kind of work? Turns out that the VXR 5000, because it uses this PLL locked to a 12.8 megahertz reference, and because my transmit frequency happens to be a really easy step to hit, 441.300, I can actually reach that with a 10 megahertz reference going into that PLL chip directly. All I have to do is reprogram the existing PLL chip. No need to synthesize the 12.8 megahertz. So in fact, we do exactly that. Build up a little PIC microcontroller that sends the serial data stream. Could have reverse engineered the firmware and the repeater, but this is easier. You reset the reference divider to assume a 10 megahertz input and the frequency divider to get 441.300 out with that 10 megahertz reference. Otherwise, you keep the serial data the same for all the various programming parameters it needs about high and low impedance inputs and outputs and all of that. You pull the power off the TCXL, we pull the coupling cap off there, you have about a foot and a half of RG174 and a capacitor and a BNC connector, and now you've got an external frequency reference input. It's a hack, but it's way cheaper than buying radios with external reference. And it's even easier than synthesizing 12.8 megahertz.
Quick question.
Yeah.
Instead of reprogramming the PLL, could you have just reprogrammed the repeater for a different frequency?
No. I looked, but it's way off. The difference between 12.8 and 10 for a reference means that you would be way out of band.
So it refused to do it.
Yes. Okay. Right. Yeah. The thing is that there's a preset, there's three or four divisors in this particular synthesizer, three of which really matter. And in order to get anywhere near where you want to be, you've got to change the reference prescaler, not the not the frequency setting divisor. And so you really need to jam the frequency prescaler to a different number than it would ever be in order to hit what you need to hit. But you're right, that's a good thing to check, is to see if there's some magic frequency you can choose that gives you the right answer. So then we got to link all these things together. So I bought a pallet of Master Exec 2s, and I said, this should be easy, you know, 420. All we got to do is buy a bunch of crystals, and then buy some more crystals when it turns out those aren't good frequencies, and then buy some more crystals when somebody shows up on one of those frequencies. But eventually we'll get there, right? And then you start testing this out, you discover, well, among other things, these are old radios, since half of them had bad capacitors, you gotta go in, and it's a never-ending thing just to get enough working. Remember, with 5 sites on the Simulcast system, I need 10 inbound audio paths, 5 inbound audio paths from the 5 things, so 5 transmitters, 5 receivers back at the central site, and I need a transmitter at the central site to get everything out, and I need 5 more receivers out of the remote sites, and that's if I don't grow. That's a lot of radios. So that never worked. So then we said, okay, what's the cheapest possible thing we could do to prove that this works at all? And we knew Hamtronic's boards were terrible, but we bought some anyway and put them in some really RF-tight cases and made some mods to the boards to make them sort of work. And the advantage here is they're newer and they're frequency synthesized. So now when we discover that we'd accidentally created an intermod somewhere, we could just dial in a new 420 link frequency and retune. And that didn't really work for a bunch of reasons, mostly having to do with them being Hamtronic's boards. And so I bought a pallet of ICOM F420 commercial mobiles, the -9 version, again from Canada. Because Canada has a public safety band, it's 410 to 430, which overlaps our 420 link band. And what you discover is that there's just too many radios. There's too many radios for this to ever work. You've got to get the audio flat and phase matched all through all of these various receive paths and through all the transmit paths. Which means you've got to be adjusting levels everywhere. You've got to adjust clipping everywhere. You have to avoid creating your own intermod. You have to get enough RF cabling and filters all at the central site to even make this work. And you're looking at like several racks of equipment at the central site to tie all this stuff together. We never got more than 2 sites ever linked ever with this stuff. And even then, they didn't sound very good. The other thing was we needed a voter back at the central site. And of course, LDG came out with this cheap software-ish, hardware-ish voter. Tried that. It's okay. It has a huge amount of crosstalk on all the audio paths. So any unsquelched receiver leaks noise through to every other thing in the entire unit. And it's not particularly good at making a decision after something's come through an RF link path because the band response is so narrow. So I also started looking at building my own voter out of software. And then one day I had an epiphany on that. And we'll get to that in a couple of slides. But the other part is, remember, we got all these analog radios, we got them all linked out. We still have that delay problem. All the transmitters have to be in phase. So I bought one just to play with it. Allen Avionics makes this device, used to make this device, very heavy, very small. It is a microsecond selectable delay, all pass filter, all analog, jam-packed with capacitors and inductors. It's really cool. Crazy, but it works. So then we went to this idea, we built this PIC-based linking controller for 2 reasons. One is, we wanted to build a digital delay line. And the second is, remember all those analog link radios and everything? Well, when you key up, you gotta have your PL decoded out in each of those remote receivers. Then they've gotta key up the link transmitter, they gotta turn on the PL encoder, it's gotta go to the remote side of that central site, PL decoder has to open there. Voter has to decide which of you sounds best, transmit that back out to the output, encode PL there, and that has to be decoded to the remote site, and that's like a second from keying up until your voice coming out on the Safar side. And so you get all this front-end clipping on the system. So In addition to doing a digital delay, we built these boards that did digital signaling over the analog link path so that when they were unkeyed, nothing would happen. But when it actually keyed up, it would key up the thing, send a digital code, send a digital idle sequence. As soon as it needed to send audio, it would go ahead and send audio. And then when it was done, it would come back to transmit this digital idle code, which was at 2 kilobits per second. So you could squelch up and unsquelch real fast. We also transmitted some telemetry, ID, and eventually it would send a turnoff code saying, hey, I'm going to actually unkey the transmitter, so just ignore what happens until I send you the turnoff code again. Those are kind of cool. By now, I have money but no time, so these projects, you just build them. You go into your CAD software and you lay out boards, and you have boards made for you, because it's, you know, I like soldering and stuff, but I don't have time for that. So here's a CBSD codec. This is 3 PIC microcontrollers. They're so cheap that there's no reason to figure out how to do multiprocessing in a single one of them. You just have one as the transmit modem, one as the receive modem. Here's the transmit modem. That's a resistor ladder D to A. This is the receive modem, using a zero crossing detector and off of one of these op amps. And then this is the controller for the delay. These kind of work, they would have worked well if we had had a good audio path back, but all those that hard audio paths did not work. Here's the link hub. Same thing, only a lot more big micros on it. And real transistors, because why not? So the outcome of that experiment was, as I said, it's terrible. This is fun. I spent a bunch of years doing this. I had big piles of radios in my garage, and I learned to tune them, and then I sent them away. I got new piles of radios, and I learned to tune them, I sent them away. It's a great excuse for buying this nice service monitor, things like that, but it never worked. So, I came up with this idea. You can align the output of all of these voice over IP things. If you link it all, you put little computers at each site, you send voice over IP out to the site, now we got wideband audio, sounds really good, really clean, really flat. The only problem was, how do you get them to all come out of the computers at exactly the same time? So, we figured that out. And then we built a new link controller out of a NEC 5501. It's a little AMD Geode single board computer running Linux and a M-Audio Pro audio card. And then you just got to get IP out to the sites and write some software. So here's the problem. You've got this unknown delay from the input signal to the samples arriving in your software. You've got an unknown delay from generating samples in your software from those incoming voice over IP packets to the actual audio output. And you need all these samples to come out at exactly the same time, within 10 microseconds. But we do have the 1 pulse per second signal coming from GPS as a reference. So we do know what time it is. And we could build custom hardware to do this. And in fact, we may in the future build some custom hardware to do this. And others have built custom hardware to do this, including the micro node thing for the All-Star Link now has some custom hardware to do this. But a software-only solution is easier, and we can build it faster. So here's how the software-only solution works. Remember that hack for the PLL, so you don't have to actually build anything? Same thing, only a little different. We've got a 4-channel audio card. We're running at 96 kilohertz sample rate. If we were at 100 kilohertz, each sample would be 10 microseconds apart. So we're darn close. And we have 16 or 24 bits of audio per channel. So what we do is we take the first channel, we tie that in, we put the receiver audio into the card, the transmit audio, out of the card. Obviously, have to do that. Then we take the GPS 1 pulse per second signal, which is this really funky little ECL pulse coming out of the thing, really short pulse. And we take that, we run that into another input on the audio card, not a TTL input, not a GPIO input on the computer, but into the audio card. And because all 4 channels are sampled together and generated together in the audio card off the same reference, what we see is that about every 96,000 samples, we see a pulse on the input. fact, for most of the cards that I own, it's 96,008. One of them is 96,007. But it's close enough. And so what we do is we can sample these, and now you can see once a second, there's a big pulse on the input of the second channel. And so now we know if we run a clock and we adjust the clock against that, we now know the time within a second that each sample comes in. So now we can align, phase align all those received audio samples. You get an audio sample in that happened at the same time as that pulse, that's the top of the second. You get that in 10 samples later, that's 100 microseconds later. And so now you get an exact timestamp of all those received audio samples. And that's helpful for making these better voter decisions, but it doesn't solve the transmit problem. The transmit problem actually involves the simplest piece of hardware I have ever built in my life. And why? Which connects a single output to a single input. What you do now is you generate a pulse once every second. It appears here. If it appears at the same time as this one, you win. If it's early, next time you send it later. If it's late, next time you send it earlier. Because you can actually watch how long it takes for this to come in on this port, you actually can preset the frequency portion right away. You just watch the pulses for a few times and you go, yeah, it's about 96,008. Great, that's a good starting point. And then you use a phase lock loop in software to drive this output to the same position as this input. Once you've done that, you now can tell the actual time in the second every output sample is being sent. And because they're at 96 kilohertz, and that's almost exactly just a little shy of 10 microseconds that you were looking for, you can now move your audio back and forth in time at any site by 10 microseconds. So now all we have to do is receive the audio, we put timestamps on it, bucket it up into 20 millisecond clips, where the first 20 millisecond clip starts exactly at the top of the second. There's 50 of them every second. We send them off to the central voter site. The central voter site sends us back the best one with a new timestamp on it that says exactly when to send it, and we put it out the output. In fact, we do one better, which is because there's extra processing power here at the remote sites, and because we're sampling at 96 kilohertz and 24 bits, we do all of the DSP required for the signal-to-noise decision out there, where we have lots more data, and the entire passband, including up into the squelch area, way out of 5, 6, 7 kilohertz of noise. We can use all of that information before we resample the audio down to a more compact audio format. And so every packet that goes out has the site identifier, it has the signal-to-noise measurement, and it has the audio for that frame. The voter's only job is to collect everything for one frame, pick the one with the highest number, send it back. So you put that whole thing together. Here's a site block diagram. You've got an antenna up on the tower, comes in through a telewave duplexer, bandpass filtering, this is Mount Toro, we got an LPTV UHF transmitter there, right next to us on the tower, so we need extra bandpass. GasFET preamp, really hot receives. We can have really hot receivers compared to our transmitters because, you know, if you're not in the coverage of this transmitter, we still want to receive you here so that it's one more thing for the voting mix, even if you're listening to a different transmitter. Goes into the repeater, send that over to the controller. What comes back goes out the transmitter. Transmitter's locked to this 10 megahertz reference. We explained how that works earlier. Isolator, low pass filter, duplexer, back out to the antenna. And then, over on the other side, we've got our computer and audio card with one pulse per second from the GPS, and the audio and COR push to talk from the repeater. And in this case, we have a 600 milliwatt link on the handband, 3480 megahertz, back from Mount Toro to Amana, 46 miles. 3-foot dishes, and that carries 24 megabits per second, of which we need about 100 kilobits. So the rest is available for other things. back to our site. So here's the new Mount Toro site. All we've got here is the repeater, right here, little controller unit, GPS, and then on the back side is power and all the RF filtering. It's the whole site. Now, the other thing we do, of course, is we link this all together with microwave because we want to bypass the commercial internet to where the extent possible. And we want to have nice low latency because if we go through a high latency link, we have to bump out that transmit time to the worst of the paths. So, variety of link technologies. One of the mid-Bonnie Dune site on Empire Grade, 14 miles, 5,900 megahertz with Ubiquiti rockets. Those are running at over 100 megabits per second. They report 100 and something, way over 100 in both directions on 2-foot dishes. 3,400 megahertz, 46 miles, 3.4 is exceptionally quiet. There's a little sliver of it that occasionally has some contest activity. There's one guy in the Bay Area doing some stuff with it, and there's me. And if you're up in the Monterey Bay and you're trying to do stuff, you find a big OFDM carrier there, that's me. We do try to stay out of the weak signal segments because we're nice. We're working on engineering a path from Bonnie Dune all the way down to Point CERN, which will be a bypass of all of their internet and phone connectivity and that comes in from the south. And we got lots of extra stuff, so we can have cameras, voice over IP phones, phone patches, Echo Link and IRLP, whatever. And we do. Several of these sites we have, we provide the only internet path, for instance, for this Bonnie Dune site. There's a repeater there, it's got Echo Link, it's got IRLP, we got a camera, all of that comes over that microwave. Another picture. This is a structure that's got four big microwave dishes on it, and at 3 feet you can actually get permission from a site owner to squeeze in between all the other dishes. A little bit of unistrut and pipe, and there's a 3-footer talking 46 miles. Super solid link. We have 22, like almost every day I've checked, it's 22 dB signal to noise at 24 megabits. More than enough, even when it's real. Here's the other end. This is the link over to Toro. This is the Bonnie Dune link. It's linked to my house. And so it worked well. We got Simulcast running in April of 2009, and by July of 2010, we had all the sites up and going. We got a occasional failed reboots on the computers. A couple of the 3801s have failed, one spectacularly. but we're doing pretty well. This is the current coverage computed for the system. This is King City down here. And so we have some San Mateo coastline missing. We're working on that. We have a little stretch of 101 that's not covered.
So what? The dots there. So Umanum is the one up.
Yeah. So this is Umanum, Allison, two in Bonnie Dune. One is a fill-in site down low. This is the upper one that we're putting back online. And this is Toro down here. So in the future. We're working on making this available to Aries and Races. We've been giving them a lot of talks. We formed a nonprofit to own all of the system. We're slowly transferring stuff and contracts over to the nonprofit. That means that I can get employer matching every time I donate money to myself. It's not really myself, but you get the gist.
The cause.
There's some new GPS unit. The Tribble Thunderbolts are now out on the surplus market. Much smaller, much easier to deal with. Only annoying thing about them is power supplies. They need plus and minus 5 and plus 12. I've built a little piggyback board that sits on top of them, takes 12 volts in, gives a super low noise, filtered, and just plugs right into the power connector on there. Hopefully I'll finish that board design up and make that available commercially. The All-Star Link guys, as I say, built a PIC-based controller, and it will do simulcast, talks on the All-Star stuff. Lower latency, but doesn't sample at as high a rate, and so it doesn't get to do some of the stuff we do for DSP. I have a dev board sitting on my desk with a little Cortex M4 processor and enough high performance low noise A to D on sitting next to it that will we might build some replacements out of a little lower latency, a little more reliable. But what we have works now. And we're expanding. We're trying to. We're working on a replacement site. We got kicked out of a site up on Upper Empire Grade. So right around the corner is a much better site with a much taller tower. And so my wife and I purchased that a few weeks ago. So as soon as the tower is cleaned up, we'll be able to move on to there. We're working on San Bruno Mountain. Some of the people in the room know about San Bruno Mountain. And they're working on new sheds there. We're working on a site for the San Mateo Coast, working on Big Sur, Point Sur, and then some points south in the Big Sur Valley. And then the very south end of the Salinas Valley as well. If you count not the sites we'd like to be on, but just the ones we're in active discussions to put radios there, that's what the coverage would look like if we finish it out. So you see there's just a little bit of Butno Park. There's a little valley in there that has a hole. And then this is the Pinnacles, north end of the Pinnacles. There's a little hole. And then otherwise, almost everywhere where there's people is covered. This whole area here would be solid if we could get on Williams Hill, which is a thing that has a lot of politics associated with it.
There. Good luck.
Yeah, the nice thing about Williams Hill is that the new Army rules on Williams Hill have meant that four different commercial users that are inside the compound are so pissed off they might actually move out and build a new tower. And if that happens, I'll help them build that tower. So that's a quick summary. We have a few more minutes for questions. Several minutes for questions. And wb6ece.org has info about the system. All the sites have standalone PL tones in case the linking system does go down. All of those sites can stay available, just standalone. If you use 100 hertz, you come across the entire simulcast system. Right here where you are here, you got two repeater sites looking at you. And if you can tell that it's two and not one, show me how you can tell and I'll fix it. Any questions? Yes?
So is the software open source or available for purchase or?
I would never charge money for it. The software is kind of ugly. if you needed it for something, we can talk. I might open source it. The All-Star guys did open source their software, and to the extent it brings everything into a central site, does the same stuff, it's very similar. In my case, the primary difference is that I use GPS at the central site to establish a firm deadline by which all the inbounds must have been received, which helps a little for jitter, basically, on the outbound path. But it's maybe 1,000 lines of code total between the inbound and the outbound and the DSP. Send me a note. Yep.
The Ubiquiti gear that you're using for 3.5, is it?
Yeah.
Are you having to buy like an international model to get it to go in the hand?
So most of the Ubiquiti gear that I bought in the past was bought back when Ubiquiti was playing a little more fast and loose with the rules. The 3.4 links that are active are the SR3 cards. So that predates all of that stuff. One of the advantages of my job is I was sort of the senior most, and now I'm still on the ladder. I was the senior most architect for Skype when Skype was acquired by Microsoft. And most of our development is done in Tallinn, Estonia, and Prague, Czech Republic, and Stockholm. And I go there a lot.
A few Ubiquiti distributors, if you show them your license,
they will. Yeah, some will if they have the ability to get it. Yeah. But it's even easier to just have it shipped to your office in Prague.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I haven't been to Prague for almost 3 weeks at this point. Anything else? Okay.
Thank you.